5 seconds. We are live.
Welcome to the 36th annual Toronto Socialist Action May Day celebration. We acknowledge that this gathering takes place on the unceded territories of the Mississaugas of the New Credit and Haudenosaunee people and on Indigenous lands all across Turtle Island. Today, I'm speaking to you from Jamaica, where the Indigenous Taino and Arawak-speaking people began arriving here 4,000 years ago, but were wiped out by European colonial powers. We join in the fight for justice, recognizing that there can be no real reconciliation without restitution. That entails seizing the assets of the big resource corporations and returning them to the commons. Due to the sixth wave of COVID-19 pandemic, this is again an unusual International Workers' Day. Around the world, millions are marking the occasion both online and in the streets. Workers are demanding proper health care, a living wage for all, an end to inter-imperialist war in Ukraine, an end to destruction of the environment, no return to austerity, and a halt to big business rule. My name is Elizabeth Bice. I'm a retired member of the Canadian Union of Postal Workers, Federal Treasurer of the NDP Socialist Caucus, a leading member of Socialist Action, and your host for this evening. We dedicate this event to the memory of Robbie Mahood, a leading member of Socialist Action, a pro-choice doctor, internationalist, and revolutionary socialist. Currently, we are celebrating the 28th anniversary of the founding of Socialist Action in Canada. Our annual education conference will be held online 4 weeks from now on Saturday, June the 4th. We warmly invite all of you to attend online. It will feature speakers from the US, Canada, and beyond. So please don't miss it. And if you want to change the world, get directly involved in our party. We warmly invite you to join Socialist Action. It is fitting at this time that we remember those who helped to build socialist and working class movement through a lifetime of dedication. We want to honor the lives of some outstanding individuals who passed away within the last year. Robbie Mahood, 75. A founding member and a leading light in Socialist Action League for Action Socialists, passed away in Montreal on December the 26th, 2021. He lost his long battle against cancer following a stroke on December the 24th. Robert Fisher Mahood was born in Saskatchewan in 46. As a teenager, he witnessed a battle for Medicare in that province. Impacted by the youth radical of the 1960s, he gradually embraced revolutionary Marxism. After studying history and politics at the University of Regina, he went into medicine and was active in the fight for abortion rights, collaborating with pro-choice activists and Dr. Henry Morgenthaler in opening and operating his Winnipeg clinic. Robbie was a semi-retired family physician in Montreal and a leading member of Socialist Action to the end. Bud Schultz, a member of Socialist Action USA in Minneapolis, passed away on February the 11th. Bud was a working class fighter focused on union work and labor struggles. He was involved in the P9 strike at the Ormill meatpacking plant in Austin, Minnesota, and in the 1980s. That is where he developed many of his political ideas and organizing skills. Bud loved to talk about socialism, especially with young people. Some Teamsters that came to his funeral spoke about how he helped them staff their call center when they were on strike. He was always in solidarity with workers' struggle. He volunteered weekly at May Day Books up until he died of natural cause at age 74. Alain Cravin, a prominent French revolutionary socialist, died on March the 12th at the age of 80, a leader in the student and anti-imperialist movement in the 1960s, an important figure in the May 1968 upheaval in France. He was for many years one of the best known figures of the French left. He was a leader of the Revolutionary Communist League, LCR, section of the Fourth International in France, and later of the new anti-capitalist party, NPA. He ran for president of France in 1969 and in 1974, and was elected to the European Parliament, serving from 1999 to 2004. Alain led a break of the youth wing from the French Communist Party over the CP's betrayal of Algeria's struggle for independence, and he popularized the Trotskyist concept of permanent revolution. Frank Shaw, a beloved figure on the Toronto left, passed away on February the 10th at the age of 102. Frank was a longtime Quaker pacifist. He and his wife, Isabel, welcomed Latin American refugees from the death squad dictatorships of the 60s, 70s, and 80s. Housed war resistors who arrived in Toronto with no place to stay, journeyed to the war zone in Nicaragua, witness for peace, to try to prevent the use of Canadian weaponry by the terrorist contras against the people of Nicaragua. Frank worked on the cruise missile conversion program in the 1980s. Shay Calavar, a longtime anti-war activist, supporter of Science for Peace, and a perennial political candidate, passed away on February 11 at age 80. His bright smile, infectious laugh, and his One World t-shirt was commonplace at Toronto social justice events. Tonight, we also honored a member of countless other militants in Palestine, Kurdistan, Iran, Afghanistan, Egypt, Syria, Turkey, Haiti, Sri Lanka, Colombia, Philippines, Ukraine, the Donbass region, South Africa, and many other countries who fell in struggle against imperialism and its client regime. Please, wherever you are, observe a moment of silence in honor of all the artists, worker, militant, and socialists who have left us in the past year. Remember, today, April the 28th, is annual day of mourning for those who died due to injury on the job. So we honor also the victims on unsafe working conditions. So comrades, we will just take a moment to remember. The Internationale is the anthem of the worldwide socialist and workers' movement. To lead us in song is Y.C. Lee. He is a tenor who performs opera and art song and is a part of the No Pride and Police Coalition. He will sing the Internationale in English, French, and Spanish. Dave?
Arriba los pobres del mundo, que tienen los esclavos y paz. Y gritemos todos unidos, ¡viva la internacional! Removamos todas las trabas que nos impiden nuestro bien. Cambiemos el mundo de voz, oyendo al imperio burgués. Agrupémonos todos en la lucha final y se alcen los pueblos por la internacional. Agrupémonos todos en la lucha final y se alcen los pueblos comprador es la internacional. Le vous les damnés de la terre, le vous les forçats de la faim, la raison dans nos cratères, c'est l'éruption de la faim. Du passé faisant table rase pour les Slaves debout. Le monde va changer de base, nous ne sommes rien soyons. C'est la nuit finale, groupons-nous et demain. L'international sera le genre vivant, c'est la lutte finale, groupons-nous et demain. L'international sera le genre humain. Arise, ye prisoners of starvation, arise, ye wretched of the earth. For justice thunders condemnation, for a better world's in a birth. No more traditions change shall bind us, arise, ye slaves, no more enthralled. The earth shall rise on new foundations. We have been not, we shall behold. 'Tis the final conflict. Let each stand in its place. The international working class shall be the human race. 'Tis the final conflict. Let each stand in his place. The international working class shall be the human race.
Wow. Once again, we thank YC Lee for allowing us to play that recording of the Internationale. Sisters and brothers, comrades and friends, once again, welcome to the 36th Annual Toronto Socialist May Day Celebration. Can you imagine, for 36 years, we have sustained this fabulous celebration. I extend a warm welcome to our friends across Canada, the United States, Mexico, and beyond. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce our first guest speaker. Skylar Williams is a member of the Six Nations of the Grand River. He has been the designated spokesperson for the 1492 Land Back Lane. That's the name Indigenous people gave Mackenzie Meadows when they began occupying it on July the 19th, 2020, since it is seated on the Osante territory. Skylar is a third-generation iron worker, a member of Local 736 of the Iron Workers Union, and a longtime community activist. Welcome, Skylar.
Hey, thanks for having me. I'm really grateful to be able to have this opportunity to speak with you all. I mean, the last couple of years at Land Back Lane have been a very trying one, to say the least. And so, like, we are facing a lot of the court backlash and threats of jail for lots of folks here at Land Back Lane. And you know what, to see the solidarity that's happened across, you know, over and over and over across the country, to be able to see just how much people are coming together, just to see how much the hurts of the past have lessened slightly. And so people are starting to work together again and coming and making those connections together. This year, being able to do that work in Wet'suwet'en territory out in BC, as well as encampment support work that's happening in Toronto and Hamilton and all around Southern Ontario. And you know what, these types of issues certainly affect Indigenous people, you know, at a far higher number than anybody else. And so when we talk about Land Back, like, Land Back is about an invitation. You know, Land Back is about an invitation to all of those brothers and sisters that have been stolen from our communities, from our nations. And to be able to say, you know, you are welcome back to a community that's growing and thriving. And you know what, when we as communities, you know, join those resistance movements together, like, the amount of work that we can do and accomplish is something that is, you know, it has no bounds. And so just in closing, you know, I just really, really appreciate the words from everybody that follows. I'm really grateful again to be able to have this chance. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Skylar. Our next speaker is Sandra Griffith Bonaparte. She immigrated in 1988 to Canada from Grenada in the Southeast Caribbean. For 12 years, she has been president of Local 70607 of the Union of National Defense Employees, a component of the Public Service Alliance of Canada. Sandra is a member of Socialist Action, was the Workers' Action Movement candidate for second vice president of the Canadian Labor Congress. Welcome, Sister Sandra. You're muted.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, dear.
Okay. So my name is Sandra Griffith Bonaparte, and I am the president of the Union of National Defense Employees, Local 70607, a local of over 2,000 members. In 2019, I faced massive discrimination from some local presidents and was suspended for something I did not do. I was suspended for 10 months. It was a blatant attack on me because of my race and my gender. During those 10 months, I had time to reflect on my role as a union representative of the Union of National Defense Employees, a component of Public Service Alliance of Canada, and whether I believe that I should continue as a rep. After tremendous agonizing, I decided to continue my work as a worker and for the workers, not only in my local, but in my community. Comrades, May 1st brings back incredible memories from my native land, Grenada. In Grenada, it's a festive occasion. On May 1st, Grenadians, like many other comrades worldwide, come together to celebrate and honor workers. This is a holiday to celebrate the contributions of workers to the economy and society, and also a time to highlight where progress still needs to be made towards fair and safe working conditions. I could vividly remember the festive parades, which would culminate in a massive and powerful rally with speeches and singing and dancing. On that day, the focus would be on workers' rights. May 1st also has significant resonance in Grenada because it coincides with the arrival of hundreds of indentured servants who were brought to Grenada and surrounding islands. Workers would gather at various points in the city, and then they would march to Queen's Park in St. George's, Grenada. The beautiful fanfare enthralled me, and I always longed for May Day, as it was favorably known. Another aspect of May 1st was the May Pole. I don't know if you know about it. It's a dancing pole decorated with pretty colors, a typical display of festivities on May Day and sometimes on Carnival. May Day is your day, workers. So let's continue to fight for each other because workers matter. Let's continue to fight against the government's austerity and put workers first because workers matter. Let us stand up and defend workers' rights so that they could be free of injustices, discrimination, and harassment because workers matter. Let us continue to fight to eradicate homophobia, xenophobia, and any phobia that will blind our view because workers matter. And because workers matter, we would use all of our resources as unions and union members to ensure that we get a fair contract, fair wages, and fair treatment from our employer. Let us continue the fight, not only this May Day, but every day. Forward ever, backward never, and solidarity to all.
Thank you, Sandra. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Jaime Gonzalez. He has been a longtime revolutionary socialist since 1968 and a founding member of the Socialist Unity League, LUS, the sister party of Socialist Action in Mexico. Welcome, Jaime. So glad to have you here, comrade.
I'm glad to be here with you too. And please receive warm greetings from the Liga de Unidad Socialista. I don't have many good news from Mexico from the point of view of the workers' movement. The workers' movement in Mexico is currently passing through one of its lowest points in living memory, with only a handful of bright spots. One of these has been the recognition of a legitimate union representation in a large General Motors plant in a city called Silao in the state of Guanajuato. That's in the center of Mexico, more or less. A little background on that and why this is so significant. In going back to the end of the 1940s and the beginning of the 1950s, a very important, crucial episode of the Cold War took place in Mexico. This is little known. This is not something that is widely known. And the fact is that Mexico, being a border country with the United States, was taken very seriously during the planning of of what would become the Cold War, and especially before, because the Mexican workers' movement was divided at that time between a nationalist leadership, which was aligned with the Mexican government, and the Stalinist and Stalinist communists, both of the Communist Party and another branch led by Lombardo Toledano. Some of you must have known about Lombardo Toledano. He was one of the main enemies of Trotsky. When Trotsky was granted asylum in Mexico. But the fact is that there was a deep offensive against any independent union, and especially against the Stalinist-controlled unions. And the victory by the nationalist leadership controlled by the government was almost total, where pressure was not enough. The gangsters from the nationalist party led by the government took over with machine guns or whatever was necessary. This was helped largely by the United States and the U.S. Union bureaucracy. Their victory was almost total. And of course, a post-war economic boom facilitated this iron-fisted control, as well as a deeper and deeper degeneration of the union movement. As today, the union movement in Mexico has not recovered from this catastrophe. Fast forward to our present days, U.S. and Canadian unions pressed very hard during the negotiations during 2019-2020 of the current edition of the NAFTA treaty, the NAFTA commercial treaty, because they correctly saw that it was completely unfair for Canadian and U.S. unions to compete with the extremely low cost of Mexican labor, and of course the horrible working conditions imposed by these by the continuation of the union bureaucracy, which I very very briefly narrated what was there or that resulted from this Cold War episode. This pressure by U.S. and Canadian unions provided an opening, and the victory at Silao was a consequence of a movement inside the plant, but supported by unions in the U.S., which supervised the elections and permitted this victory. Unfortunately, it has not been followed by other successes. The AMLO government in Mexico has been basically a continuation of the PRI, or what I call, just for simplicity's sake, the Nationalist Party, or the of the remnants of the PRI, the Nationalist Party. It was the head of a dictatorship here in Mexico for many decades. The AMLO government has not been good news for the workers, although this pressure by U.S. and Canadian union did have as a consequence that there have been significant, but of course not sufficient, increases in the minimum wage in Mexico. Worse even, the AMLO government has provided the illusions, or has created the illusions in many unions that it would be a new chapter in Mexican labor history. It has not been so. The situation is basically the same as we confronted with the PRI and the other bourgeois party, the PAN governments. Unions are divided, workers are profoundly disoriented, and I'm afraid that next Sunday we're not going to have large militant celebrations. We are joining a small action that will take place in Mexico City by independent forces, but we know very well that we are very far from a turning point in Mexico. So that is that would be what I could what I can tell you so far. And anyway, we must remain optimists. Workers sooner or later will begin to walk on the rise, they will begin to respond, and they will begin to organize. The main weakness of the workers in Mexico is that we do not have an independent labor movement, and much less an independent workers' party. That was so. With that, I finish my description of the current situation, and thank you very much for inviting me to this talk.
Thank you, Jaime. Thank you so much for attending. And one of the most memorable memories that I have, and I'm sure Barry has too, is May Day in Mexico City, where we marched with 500,000 people behind us. We marched with, I do believe, the comrade was Rosa, who was running for president at the time there. And that was the unofficial march. But it was great. I mean, powerful. Wow, it was very powerful. Okay, so now we're going to move to some music. Kevin Barrett is the lead vocalist with the Specials Interest Group, a rock band based in Toronto's Kensington Market. And with permission, here is a recording of their song, Music in the Streets.
When I'm walking in the street, I hear the sound of a sweet melody. A single voice can start a revolution. I still believe in the song. Still believe the time has come. Your hands up high.
street. Feel the power of a sweet melody. A single voice can start a revolution. I still believe in the song. I do believe our time has come. So let me tell you now, hey, 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 hey. Raise your hands up high. Raise your hands up high. Hey, 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 hey. Raise your hands up high. Raise your hands up high.
So thanks again to Kevin Barrett with the Special Interest Group. Our next speaker is Barry Weisletter. Barry brings together labor unionism, independent working class political action, and revolutionary socialist politics. For 20 years, he was the president of the Toronto Substitute Teachers. He is a former OFSU executive board member and is chair of the NDP Socialist Caucus. He is a co-editor of Turn Left magazine and the Federal Secretary of Socialist Action Canada. Please welcome Comrade Barry Weisletter.
Good evening, comrades, siblings, and friends. International Workers' Day, unlike Labor Day in September, is the occasion to celebrate not only workers' solidarity and our past gains, but the struggle for socialism. May Day is rooted in the quest for a world without exploitation and oppression. Socialist action has been at the forefront of May 1st actions for decades. Clearly, on May Day 2022, despite big challenges, there are some positive signs. Young workers are organizing unions. Witness the breakthrough at Amazon in the United States. Witness the successful unionization drives at WestJet, Indigo Bookstores, Canada Goose in Winnipeg, various Starbucks locations, at a Vancouver hotel, and a near win at Staples in Oakville. Celebrate the election of a new progressive president of the Ontario Public Service Employees Union and the triumph of Teamsters for a Democratic Union across North America. Note the significant support for the Workers' Action Movement candidates at the recent CLC and OFL conventions and the re-election of revolutionary socialists to leading positions in OPSU and the Public Service Alliance. The so-called Great Resignation shows that young workers are fed up with low-wage, insecure jobs, and they're fighting back. But there's no denying the fact that these are tough times. Inter-imperialist rivalry dominates the headlines. The conflict in Ukraine, triggered by the expansion of NATO to the borders of Russia, threatens nuclear war. Russia's brutal and horrendous invasion has strengthened rightist forces in Ukraine and beyond. Anti-war protests, still relatively small, struggle to highlight the crimes of Washington, London, Paris, Ottawa, and their imperialist allies. We stand with anti-war activists in Russia and in the West. The US-led Cold War against China, a sign of declining American economic hegemony, can easily grow into a hot war with catastrophic consequences for humanity. First and foremost, we oppose the war moves of our own ruling class. The answer is not so-called multipolarity and identification with opposing authoritarian regimes. The answer is workers' revolutionary self-organization from the bottom up for world socialist transformation. Rapid global warming caused by fossil fuel capitalism puts all life on Earth at risk. The world faces multiple unavoidable climate hazards over the next two decades, with global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius. Risks for society will increase, including to infrastructure and low-lying coastal settlements. Increased heat waves, droughts, and floods already exceed the tolerance of plants and animals, driving mass mortalities in species such as trees and corals. weather extremes are occurring simultaneously, causing cascading impacts that are increasingly difficult to manage. They expose millions of people to acute food and water insecurity, especially in Africa, Asia, Central and South America, on small islands and in the Arctic. The pandemic arising from deforestation and the expansion of agribusiness is not disappearing. Coronavirus cases are over 450 million, deaths over 6 million. Less than 20% of the peoples of the less developed countries are vaccinated even once, let alone three times. Patent protection ensures mega profits for big pharma and future waves of fatal COVID variants. In Ontario's 14 largest hospital systems, over 2,900 healthcare workers are currently off sick leave, off sick due to COVID, resulting in surgery cancellations or delays and reduced emergency department hours. The brutal 40-year policy of neoliberalism continues, ramping up again in the West following a short COVID pause. Price inflation is surging at a 31-year high. Workers and peasants the world over are being impoverished to the point of severe sickness, starvation, and death, while billionaires are becoming trillionaires. Restrictions on travel and indoor gatherings are being lifted, in some cases too rapidly, even recklessly. Excess mortality during 2020 and 2021 stands at 18 million, suggesting an even larger impact on societal health. By prioritizing profit over people, big business governments risk pandemic regression. Debt, waste, and inequality put the world on course for a great recession in 2019. Well, the pandemic, it made things much worse, plunging humanity into a global depression. Bourgeois politicians claim to care while they buy oil pipelines and trample indigenous people and sell weapons of mass destruction. Inequality surges. Haters stoke fears. Racism, sexism, and homophobia rise. They promote authoritarian rule and wage wars of imperialist plunder. Human civilization is at risk. The choice is socialism or barbarism. If we are to survive, revolutionary change is urgent. Vital to the change we need is international working class solidarity. Capitalism is approaching a terminus, is dragging life on Earth down with it. Either we defeat it or die. That is the choice, and the stakes have never been higher. Today, we stand in solidarity with the Palestinian people for boycott, divestment, and sanctions against the Zionist apartheid state. And we stand with Cuba, Venezuela, Syria, and Iran against imperialist intervention. We condemn the criminal blockade imposed by Ottawa, Washington, and the EU, who target countries for regime change because they stand in the way of imperial super profits. More than ever, it is clear that capitalism is a dying system that threatens to destroy nature and humanity. Capitalist rulers are cut funding to public health services and medical research. They failed to provide protective gear and paid extensive sick leave. They limit brave personal care workers to part-time hours, low wages, and no benefits. They close borders to starving millions displaced by war and climate change. This is mass murder rooted in capitalism. There is an alternative to this genocidal system, a rational, democratic, humanistic, and cooperative alternative, socialism. But a major obstacle to socialism is the conservative bureaucratic leadership of the unions and the NDP. The labor fakers must be replaced by class struggle militants. Socialist Action is at the forefront of the workers' action movement and the Socialist Caucus, which won the NDP to the fight for a $20 an hour minimum wage. WAM says, stop concessions bargaining, no to two-tier wages and benefits, hands off our pensions, mass job action to end austerity, make the rich pay for the pandemic, smash racism, sexism, and homophobia in the workplace and in the unions, defund the police. We demand that Jagmeet Singh and the NDP break with the minority federal Liberal government. The Liberal NDP pact means Singh will vote for increases in war spending and war profits. He will back wars in which working class families die or become refugees. Singh's commitment to provide the Liberals with, quote, confidence and supply implies endorsement for beefing up the Canadian forces to participate in NATO wars, as it did in Afghanistan, in the Balkans, and in Libya. It involves backing the NATO puppet regime in Kyiv, providing lethal aid to Nazi battalions battering the Donbass, shipping weapons to the Saudi monarchy, pulverizing Yemen, and boosting the Israeli apartheid state. It means backing any moves by Trudeau to complete the TMX pipeline and to continue underfunding healthcare and ignoring the needs of Indigenous people. We say, organize the unorganized, no to union raiding. For international working class action against trade wars, hot wars, repression, and military occupation. For union democracy, pay union officials a worker's wage. To achieve socialism, we advance transitional demands to increase the confidence and capacity of the working class to achieve gains, then to win power. Socialist action demands basic income for all, regardless immigration status. Nationalize big pharma and all private long-term care facilities. Put a moratorium on residential rents and mortgage payments. No evictions. Cancel student debt. Make education free. Expropriate the big landlords. Build quality, accessible social housing on a mass scale. Nationalize the telecoms. Tax the rich. Expropriate the big banks, the giant oil and gas corporations. Move rapidly to green, sustainable energy under public ownership and workers' control. The present mode of production is capitalism for the poor and socialism for the rich. It must be replaced by a cooperative commonwealth, a genuine economic democracy. The rich and powerful, they will resist tooth and nail, but only a socialist revolution led by a mass revolutionary workers' party deeply rooted in the majority class can overcome the power of the elite. Only in that way can we unleash the full potential of humanity in harmony with nature. No individual or party can accomplish this task alone. That is why Socialist Action is committed to the tactic of the United Front. Broad unity in action on a specific set of demands magnifies the power of the grassroots. For that reason, Socialist Action helped to initiate the Municipal Socialist Alliance in Toronto and Peel and the Vote Socialist Vancouver. We eagerly participate in United Front campaigns such as those of the Canadian BDS Coalition, the Canada Peace Network, the Canadian Network on Cuba, plus anti-poverty, anti-fascist, pro-feminist, pro-choice, pro-queer, pro-Indigenous actions. Today, we are showing the bosses that there is no retreat. The working class will continue the struggle for socialism, for freedom from all forms of oppression, for peace, social justice, equality, and for workers' power. We invite you to join Socialist Action Workers' Day rallies and marches on Sunday, May 1st in Toronto and across the country. We warmly invite you to join Socialist Action. So have a bright red May Day. Long live international worker solidarity. Long live the World Socialist Revolution.
Thank you, Barry. Our next speaker is Florencia Shade. Flo is a central committee member of Socialist Action based in Wet'suwet'en territory near a place called Burns Lake in north central British Columbia. She has a keen interest in history, philosophy, social movements, and economics, which culminated in a master's degree in religion and science at the University of Edinburgh. Flo.
Hi. Hello, comrades. I'm joining you from the traditional lands of the Wet'suwet'en peoples on the territory of the Xalkas, or Thin House, of the Gilsehu Big Fog Clan. I have a special place in my heart for May Day celebrations, not only because it was my first event with Socialist Action, but because I love the big picture thinking, United Front organizing, and generally inclusive, expansive, and resilient mindset that this day generates. Historically, May Day brought the demands for better working conditions into real-world action through general strikes, demonstrations, and rallies, resulting in not only the might of the state apparatus being violently deployed against labor, but also hard-won meaningful improvements such as the eight-hour workday. The day brings together various working-class tendencies into a common cause which sees international solidarity as a fundamental component. It has always been a time not only to commemorate the immense sacrifices of those past, but to push against the limits of current power structures in actionable ways which expand the horizons for future proletarian power. We are at a time now when people are eager to hear a message of this kind. The allure of capitalism continues to break apart under the pressure of its own contradictions, as the working masses continue to toil harder and yet fall farther behind, as the consequences of allowing greedy, parasitic, profit-driven monopolies to determine our world ravages our experience. From climate catastrophe to world hunger, to homelessness, unending war, inescapable debt, or the threat of nuclear annihilation. It's becoming clearer to a greater number of people that capitalist organization of society only encourages and rewards the most base and cruel instincts of human nature, while hindering the growth of everything we say we value: generosity, compassion, community, equality, and liberty. What's being laid bare is that our most salient ethical values are at odds with the status quo structure. It doesn't fit. Something's off. Exploitation shouldn't be the basis for survival. We're killing ourselves and our planet to keep billionaires rich. Capitalism is a beast that perpetually grows only to consume itself, and yet can never be satiated. This inherent contradiction has become so fervent and irrational that it cannot be ignored. In fact, the improvements won by 20th century labor movements have largely been rolled back or degenerated. Socialist leaders fought for an 8-hour workday so people didn't have to toil from sunup to sundown. But now, with the steep decline in labor representation, the deterioration of wages versus inflation, the rise of the unregulated gig economy and unstable service sector, many people have to take more than one job or enter precarious employment. So the result is often the same. A good job that's able to support a family, is stable, provide benefits, and retain some semblance of work-life balance is exceedingly rare. For the vast majority of 21st century workers, there remains no autonomy over one's life and conditions. We've come back to exploiting ourselves and cling with our fingertips to the receding hope of seeing our next generation do better than us. This innate discontent is a sign of how bad things have become, yes, but it's also an opportunity to provide a guiding light. People are beginning to really wake up to the problem, and now we are charged with providing the solution. To this end, I'm happy to speak about a Socialist Action United Front project in Vancouver, which is about to launch on May 1st, the Vote Socialist Municipal Election Campaign. SA, along with the Democratic Socialists of Vancouver, are running a slate for mayor, council, parks board, and school board. This party is unapologetically socialist, as the name implies, and accordingly sticks to a program of transitional demands which would create systemic changes that shift power to the working class. They're in the process of becoming an official electoral party across all of BC, with the first campaign in the municipality of Vancouver. The policy platform will focus heavily on decommodifying housing, strengthening tenants' rights, and driving capitalists out of the market. Specifically, they stand for massive, clean, free public transit, implementing UNDRIP in the city, land back and self-determination, including Indigenous veto on zoning changes, a 50% reduction in police funding diverted directly to those in need and social services. They will tax the rich with an escalating mill rate based on market value assessment of real estate. Excuse me. The launch will double as a the launch event. Oh, geez.
Okay, take your time. A bit of a cold. No problem. Take your time.
We'll double as a May Day rally, and once again bring real political action to socialist aspirations. It appears I'm losing my voice live on air, but essentially, it'll begin at 12:30 at Grandview Park on Commercial Drive, and include speakers from participating groups, as well as pamphlets about the campaign. This will be followed by another United Front information fair, during which SA will have a table to distribute various forms of literature. So while there is much to despair about in the state of the world, we should be proud and hopeful that our Socialist Action comrades are living up to the name by continuing and increasing efforts and actions directed at overturning capitalist hegemony. Please participate if you can, and in any other way that you can across the country, where similar municipal campaign efforts are being coordinated. Thank you, and solidarity.
Thank you, comrade. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is John Clark. John was born in England, moved with his family to London, Ontario, where he got involved in organizing unemployed workers. Later in Toronto, he became the leading figure of the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty, OCAP. He retired as its provincial organizer in January 2019. John then took on the post of Packer Visitor in Social Justice in the Faculty of Liberal Arts and Professional Studies at York University. It's nice to see public tax dollars going to such a good purpose. Welcome, John.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, comrades. Well, it seems to me that on this May Day, global capitalism has been doing an absolutely exceptional job of demonstrating its historical bankruptcy. And that is something that a number of comrades have already implied. And I want to sort of draw it out. There are those who have, on the left, who have long sought to deny the fundamentally crisis-ridden nature of the capitalist system, going all the way back to the polemic between Rosa Luxemburg and Edward Bernstein in 1990. But it seems to me that at this particular time, those who suggest that capitalism can be stabilized and incrementally changed in a progressive direction have a particularly tough job ahead of them, because the dimensions of the crisis that the capitalist system is now facing is really quite incredible. Obviously, on the economic front, we go through a long period after the Great Recession of sluggish recovery with the system on life support, essentially. By 2019, there is a downturn, an economic slump developing. But that is taken to levels that were absolutely incredible by the global pandemic, which is itself an expression of a very fundamental crisis within the capitalist system, which comes from its inability to create a sustainable relationship with the natural world itself. An absolutely decisive development in terms of capitalist crisis, which plays out, of course, in terms of the pandemic, but plays out as well on an even larger scale when it comes to climate change and the broader ecological crisis. So now, as the pandemic very arguably begins to come to an end, we now find ourselves in a situation where the impacts of that crisis have created supply shocks, an inflationary crisis. And we're told this is just a little blip, don't worry about it. But then, of course, along comes the horrors of the conflict in Ukraine, adding a new element of supply shock and devastation. I believe the United Nations it is that has suggested that this particular crisis emanating from the Ukraine and the shocks to supply that it will create could put a whole fifth of the human race into conditions of extreme poverty. That's the sort of the level of the complete irrationality of the profit-driven system expressing itself. And I read today the Deutsche Bank, which has been particularly hawkish on the question of interest rates, talking in terms of recession, but not talking in terms of a global recession that they can't avoid or that they're trying to stop, but actually talking of it something that should be induced, getting back to the concept of creative destruction, of a crisis that will clear things up so that stability and profit making can return. And that's, again, an expression of the extreme irrationality that we live in. And this crisis continues to deepen. It continues to play out. The situation in Ukraine is dreadful, but let's not forget that the conflict with Russia is only the second event. Is only the secondary event. The conflict with China is the bigger agenda item. And that it too is beginning to play out. The horrors of war within the capitalist system did not end with the end of the Cold War. On the contrary, they've moved over into a new direction. And as I suggested, over it all hangs an absolutely insoluble ecological crisis. I find it absolutely incredible that you can go to media and see accounts of scientists warning that if we don't make changes immediately, we're going to be facing devastating consequences. And they continue to release carbon emissions. They continue to let the polar ice caps melt. We've reached the situation where the crisis of capitalism goes beyond, I think, socialism or barbarism. It calls into question the existence of life itself on this planet. That's really the enormity of what we're facing. And we are seeing people resist. The latest cost of living crisis is producing resistance. We see movements arising in Sri Lanka. We see people taking to the streets in Peru, a real possibility of a major global upsurge. We see workers looking for a way to rejuvenate their unions and move on a counteroffensive. A crack in the edifice of the system of super exploitation that Amazon is an indication of how powerful that is. But the whole point is, and I'll say this by way of conclusion, May Day arose out of a struggle that was very practical, that sought to win immediate gains for workers, but that also had a perspective and a leadership that sought to challenge the capitalist system itself. That seems to me to be what's at stake now, is to fight on all of the fronts that this crisis is creating, but to do so in ways that pose the question of revolutionary socialist transformation in this society. That's something that's at the heart of May Day. It's something we need to celebrate. It's something we need to build upon. It's something we need to organize around. Thank you very much, comrades, and happy May Day.
Thank you, John. Inspiring as usual. Okay, so now we're going to move to Alex Padilla. He's a member of the Toronto Executive of Socialist Action and manages the Socialist Action website. He is a candidate for City Council on the Municipal Socialist Alliance team. Alex will now present a couple of his own song compositions. Alex.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Hello, comrades. My name is Alex, and I will, as Elizabeth said, we'll be doing some songs that I wrote. So the first one is called General Strike. We're all living in white slavery. We need someone to set us free. That someone is us ourselves. Yet those are depths we dare not delve. Why will no one hear our cries? The scales then fall right from our eyes. We create class consciousness. It's finally time for real progress. They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. They will call on the police, who will be telling us to cease. Their only role is to cause harm with their military arms. Tear gas spreads across the street. Rubber bullets are flesh they meet. Won't be long till they shoot to kill. But that will not destroy our will. They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. Strike! Strike! Strike for your wages! Strike! Strike! Strike for the workers! Strike! Strike! Strike for big change now! Strike! Strike! Strike for your freedom! They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. They need us more than we need them. Our civil rights they dare to condemn. Let's give them something they won't like. Let's come together in a general strike. Thank you. That was my first song. Second song and last song, COVID, it's called COVID-19, The Breakdown of Capitalism. A pandemic has reached our land, ruining everything we have planned. I place this cloth over my face, thinking of this great disgrace. They responded way too late, leaving many to their fate. There are some who still have to work as the world around them goes berserk. We have to wait till the vaccine, yeah, we'll return to feed the great machine. Ah! The poor rod dropping dead like flies, but you still can't look me in the eye when I say this cold hard fact to you. You say there's nothing you can do, you still worry about the economy. You want the market to be free, they go forward with reopening as the lives of people are cheapening. That is quite a massive task. Some people will not wear a mask, and social distancing ain't a thing. As you hear the bells of freedom ring, but those bells are for your funeral. You're so goddamn delusional! The kids are going back to school because the government is cruel. That will cause a massive spread. Many people will drop dead. It's unraveling bit by bit. CERB is not enough, you shits! I turn to socialism now, to incompetence I will not bow. Waiting for revolution must be some evolution to adjust society. I just want us to be free. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. That was great. It's great. Okay, our next speaker will be Victor Morgan. Victor is a young member of Socialist Action in Newfoundland and Labrador, a writer, and he is the SA Atlantic Region organizer. Welcome, Victor.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much. As Elizabeth said, I'm coming to you from Newfoundland, which is unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq natives and the stolen land of the Beothuk. Newfoundland has had a very struggled history with unions and with the merchant class, we used to call them here, which is just another word for capitalists. It used to be a much more derogatory term that the unions used with glee here. However, they had an iron grip on Newfoundland. The fisheries merchants basically used a roundabout slavery. They would take the fish at the end of the season, and instead of paying with cash, they would trade in staple goods, and they would inflate the price to such a ridiculous amount that the fisheries and the fishing workers were in debt to them constantly. Their entire lives were spent in debt, and it was a circular debt, and that was the design of it. So what was the answer to this from fishermen here in the province and in the country at the time? It was socialism. Basically, they decided that enough was enough with the massive, massive theft that was going on. So they decided to unionize. And in 1908, it began with just 20 men. And within a few years, it ballooned to 21,000 workers across the country of Newfoundland, which encompassed 206 separate councils. By the time that it had reached this size, they were building stores owned by the unions. They were building homes and shop fronts owned by the unions. Rather than work for the merchant class and be abused by them, they set up their own systems that they themselves managed, that they themselves operated, which eventually led to the establishment of Canada's first union town, which in Newfoundland is Port Union. It is now a heritage site. It was growing at a very incredible rate. Unfortunately, the Great Depression, the war, and the massive attacks by the merchant class stifled its growth a great deal. And after that initial boom of growth, they could not expand further. But they did get into legislature. They did get into our government here. They ran for years. And they made great, great victories. Like I said, unfortunately, due to the Great Depression, many of those victories were again lost, as the Great Depression and indeed the recession led to capitalists in further control than they had before that. They abused market systems, they abused financial institutions, and they took control of what the unions and what the workers had taken from them. And today we fight still in Newfoundland against the merchant class. Just last year, or the year before, we had the Dominion strike against Loblaws, which we saw thousands of workers across the province here go on strike. And they were on strike for months in the dead of winter, in the snow and in the rain and in the sleet. They sat there on their picket lines and in the hopes that Loblaws would buckle. But of course, where was our wonderful Liberal government but to swoop in and aid Loblaws in any action that they needed. They hired transport workers to move any sort of goods to their other locations. They eventually did manage to come to an agreement with Unifor, but their agreement was pennies on the dollar of what Unifor had asked for. Their agreement was promises that, of course, would end up being broken, of more compassionate staffing, smaller and more manageable shifts, many more people on the work floor. And of course, none of that happened. It was all smoke and mirrors to get everyone back to work, keep the profits flowing. Not months after that, we heard talk of CUPE in Grand Falls, Windsor going on strike. And we didn't know, or they didn't know, I should say, when the strike was set to occur. There was just talk of it going to happen until they showed up at their CUPE office in Grand Falls and found it to be locked. They had to go on Facebook, which of course is everyone's prime news site, to discover that they were indeed on strike, and that was decided upon by the town, and they were not informed. There was no conversation had prior to this. They were locked out, left on the street, and the town's answer to this was to hire scab workers to take over every position that the union had once held, and to pay them far more. Of course, private corporations are worth more to the eyes of the government than unionized labor is. However unfortunate it was, they did, again, in this situation, manage to get back to the negotiating table and did get, again, pennies on the dollar. Nothing close to what they asked for. Their health care is in jeopardy. Their benefits are in jeopardy. It's a complete win of the town, unfortunately. And this, through this entire process, they were slandering the union online. They were putting out shameful attacks against union members and union leadership, which is not surprising for people who are against unions. They will stoop to the lowest of the low to attack them. And why do they do this? Well, they fear collective bargaining. They fear the movement of socialism in the workplace. They do not want to have to pay the benefits to these workers. They do not want to have to pay the retirement to these workers and the pension to them. So they want to get rid of them. And if you can't fire them, then you go to the negotiating table and you hope that they buckle. And in the province now, they seek to deal a grievous wound to our unions here with the recent deal between the province and Rothschild & Co. They are set to assess, quote unquote, our assets. And we've seen before when a private company assesses the assets of the public, that always means taking it private. That means taking it away from the people, taking away the control of the voice of the people. So right now in that deal, they are assessing Nalcor, the NLC, which is the Newfoundland Liquor Corporation, and all of our registries, our land registries, our vehicle registries, pretty much the three largest union employers or government union employers in the province. So those are the three biggest targets that they seek to privatize. And of course, with privatization, these companies can then decide, well, we don't want union workers anymore. We have, you know, 100,000 people in the province that are unemployed or underemployed that we could pay a few dollars less than what we're currently paying these union workers. And that's not going to be something that the people of the province can argue against right now. We have the highest the second highest in the country in union workforce. We have between 37 and 39%, depending on when you look at the numbers. But most of that is government employment, CUPE, the towns, Nalcor, the NLC, and the registries. So if that does go private, we will lose a great deal of our union workforce here, which is what they've been trying to do in Newfoundland for, as I said at the beginning, over a century. 114 years they've been trying to deal us this wound, and they will continue to try. So this is no time, as all before me said, to give up. We must fight again for socialism in the workplace and in the streets and in our parliaments and in our legislature until we win. And even when we win, we must hold it to that. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Victor. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Jeff Mackler. Jeff is the national secretary of our sister party in the United States. He is a lifelong organizer of civil rights, anti-war, and labor solidarity. He is the West Coast coordinator of the campaign to free Mahmoud Abu-Jamal and a steering committee member of the United National Anti-War Coalition. Jeff was the Socialist Action candidate for president of the USA in 2020. Welcome back, Jeff, and I want to know why you didn't win.
Well, I did win the election because we recruited new members to the Revolutionary Party. And of course, if they counted fairly, I would have won the election.
Of course.
First and foremost, it's an honor to be with our sister party to the North, Socialist Action, and especially to hear the voices of your new young recruits. It brings joy to my heart. Things are going well for the American capitalist system. We have 1,100 military bases in 110 countries, more than the entire world combined. Our nearest, quote, competitor is Russia, with 6 military bases, and China, the great threat, with 1 military base in Djibouti. The United States spends more money on the military than virtually the entire world combined. And the war in Ukraine today is a boon for profits for the monopolized military-industrial complex. Every bomb, every missile, every tank that they send to Ukraine is additional millions and billions of dollars into the pockets of the despicable ruling rich, for whom war is good for profits. And today, wars are unprecedented. The Democrats, Obama, conducted 7 simultaneous wars. The Trump administration stopped some of those wars, but conducted them indirectly, as Biden is. We have drone wars, assassination wars, CIA wars, special operation wars, AFRICOM wars, and assassination wars of leaders throughout the world. We have no truck with United States NATO war in Ukraine. United States orchestrated a 2014 fascist-led coup that overthrew a, quote, democratically elected government and replaced it with a government with 5 fascist ministers and an open coalition fascist government that immediately sent troops to the Donbass region to slaughter, as they have done over the past 8 years, 15,000 Russian-speaking Ukrainians. We are for an end to NATO, abolition of NATO, no arms to NATO, and U.S. out of the rest of the world, including Ukraine. We have a crisis of civil liberties. If you read the headlines today, you'll find that the richest man on the planet, Elon Musk, just purchased for some extraordinary amount, $42 billion, the Twitter organization, supposedly saying that he was going to guarantee free speech, which means he was going to guarantee free speech for American corporations and ban free speech for those who he considered a threat to national security, which means the revolutionary left. We have never in US history seen such a powerful monopoly controlling virtually the entire corporate warmongering, pro-democratic party and pro-Republican party media. There is no difference in our view between the warmongering of Trump and the warmongering of the Democrats. The Biden administration has increased its drilling for fossil fuel, has increased over Trump the deportation of immigrants, and the United States under Biden deported more people than any president in history under Obama. In history, and the Biden administration is equaling and surpassing that number. Civil liberties are under grave threat, not only because of the generalized corporate-controlled media, but the case of Julian Assange, where we play a leading role in his defense. Here, the United States seeks to extradite the WikiLeaks founder for revealing what nobody denies were war crimes of the United States in Afghanistan, Guantanamo, and Iraq. He's being persecuted for telling the truth. We're also involved in a committee to defend Alice Walker, the Pulitzer Prize journalist who was banned and rescinded at her invitation by the Bay Area Book Fair, rescinded because they claimed she was an anti-Semite. In the United States, anyone who is an anti-Zionist is equated with anti-Semitism. So we have a webinar coming up. I'm moderating it with Pulitzer Prize journalist and Pulitzer Prize novelist this coming Tuesday, Chris Hedges and Alice Walker. We've secured 2,800 signatures to the book festival to rescind their disinvitation and allow Alice to speak. It's no coincidence that Alice is not only a leading opponent of Zionist Israel, of apartheid Israel, but also of all US wars. And interestingly enough, she was one of my campaign speakers in 2020. We were honored that she endorsed our presidential campaign. The United States, up until the truth came out about COVID, was the number one nation on earth with COVID deaths. We are approaching, if not exceeding, 1 million dead in the nation with supposedly the richest nation on earth, with a healthcare system that pales before the other imperialist nations. Only 60% of the American population is fully vaccinated. That tells us that for the ruling class today, who are ending mask mandates and other provisions to restrict the spread of COVID, they subordinate the health of the general population to the profits of the corporations. They want their workers, their slaves, back on the job, regardless of the nature of the COVID crisis. The reason why it's spreading worldwide is because of the blatant incapacity, inability, refusal of the capitalist nations on earth to spend the billions, if not trillions, of money needed to end the COVID horror. And in truth, it can't be ended because the COVID and all other such pandemics are a product of the capitalist systems ever encroaching on the natural world, deforestation, agricultural expansion, and that puts human beings in closer contact than ever before with the very carriers of the disease that are guaranteed to spread it in the future. On the environmental crisis and global warming, as one of your speakers previously said, we face a crisis of unprecedented proportions where the United States is increasing its fossil fuel production over the pre-pandemic levels. The recent Glasgow conference did absolutely nothing other than to put some billionaire corporations in charge of overseeing climate crisis. As the earth burns, as hurricanes and horrors continue to encroach on our seacoasts and on millions of people, global warming threatens to terminate much of life on Earth in our lifetime, if not in the next 10 years, and the Biden administration is leading the world in increasing fossil fuel production because it's profitable. When they sell barrels of oil at $100 to $110, there's no reason to not produce it forever. And finally, what's one of the factors behind the Ukraine crisis is the United States' stated goal to replace Russia as the major supplier of the majority of the fossil fuels to Germany and France and Western Europe. The United States wants to take over the market and exploit its fossil fuel monopolies to control the resources of the world to the detriment, to the death, the destruction of life itself. Comrades, I want you to know that we seriously appreciate our sister party in Canada. You're recruiting a new generation of young people, your technological advances, your participation in the NDP, your running candidates, and your inspiring youngsters who sing and perform are an inspiration to us. We value our collaboration. Long live Socialist Action Canada. Long live the comrades of Socialist Action Canada for an enduring unity in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade Jeff. Okay, Durka Prowse will now present Nightmare in My Dreams, a poem about migrant workers. Durka is a two-time federal NDP candidate for London North Centre, and she's chair of the board of directors of Unity Project, a homeless shelter in London. In her final year of high school, she won an award for creative writing and has done very little of that since then. But in 2022, this year, she pledged to get back in touch with her creative self. Welcome, Durga.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. So I am living and coming to you from the traditional territories of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, Lenni-Lenape and Chenongtong nations, and that's connected with the London Township and Sumbra Treaties of 1796 and the Dish with One Spoon Covenant, and we recognize them as contemporary stewards of the land and vital contributors to our society. So this poem is based on a profile that I saw on Kairos's Migrant Justice website and on the 2016 documentary by Min Suk Lee. The documentary is about, is called Migrant Dreams, and it's about a group of migrant workers who dare to resist the systemic oppression and exploitation from their brokers, employers, and Canadian government in a small town, Ontario. So let's go. She just needed that one job, the one job that made life more comfortable. She never dreamed of riches. She just aspired to educate her children, help her and her husband's family be their financial balm. The agent said there's only one location, pays higher than Korea or any other. Her pretty girl lovingly spelled that one location in block letters lovingly written with the stub of a red crayon, worn down by many days of birthing bouquets on recycled paper. K-A-N-A-D-A. Canada, mummy? No, my pretty one, she says. It starts with a C. Canada. Canada to just. The fair, the equitable, the one location where my dreams would be fulfilled, he thought. Whenever he visited the grave of his dead wife, a prayer went up for one employer to help break the shackles of his poverty, plant new roots for better life for him and his children, he dreamt. His dreams shared with the universe, with the promise the sun will always shine on him. Instead, it rained in the greenhouse. He could not breathe. Weather report. Heavy chemical showers in the black and brown areas. Don't forget your umbrella. A garbage bag if you're in a pinch or if you're being pinched. Respirators and PPE quite all white. Her dreams helped soothe a long day at the greenhouse, rejected debit card payment for Western Union transfer back home. Say, didn't I just get paid yesterday? And she works, and he works so hard each day. They're crying. They're dying. Their dream is dying through exhaustion-filled slumber that is skillfully evaded by nightmares, crying for a real home that is not a garage. Their dream is dying invaded by nightmares that stalk you by day, each payday with threats to send you home from away. They're crying for justice, freedom from debt bondage. No one should work so far from home, she says. My kids are failing at school, he said. Tend them. Tend with family. Sow the seeds of their labor in love. Protect the shoots with a union. Nip lies of an employer in the bud. Fertilize them with healthcare and EI access. Root them with status. Reap their dreams. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Durka. So beautiful, but yet so sad and yet so true. But I hope it inspires us to do something. Thank you so much. Okay, our next speaker is Denis Kosim. He is a member of the board of directors of the Canadian Palestinian Foundation of Quebec. He is a college professor and a member of the CSN's International Solidarity Committee. His family was displaced from Galilee, the northern part of historical Palestine, and emigrated to Canada in 1967. Welcome, Denis.
Thank you. I'm coming to you from Montreal, Quebec, traditional Mohawk territory. I salute you with, not with a Palestinian word, but with a South African word. Perhaps some of you know it. The word is amandla. In South Africa, amandla means power. And when one shouts amandla in South Africa, people respond with noethu, which means power to the people. Why do I use a South African word to salute you? Well, in the past 18 months, there have been a number of reports coming out about Israel, framing Israel as an apartheid state. The title of one of those reports, it's by B'Tselem. B'Tselem, by the way, is the leading Israeli human rights organization. So the B'Tselem report's title is From the Jordan River to the Mediterranean Sea, a regime of Jewish supremacy. This is apartheid. Of course, apartheid is a word associated with South Africa, hence my choice of the word amandla. Apartheid reframes the quote-unquote conflict. The traditional framing of Israel-Palestine is of a relationship, a political relationship, a conflict, a confrontation. The solution is partition. Negotiations are supposed to lead to peace. The new framing, the apartheid framing, presents the Israel-Palestine quote-unquote conflict not as a confrontation, not using a confrontation framework, but a domination framework. A confrontation framework suggests parity, evenness. A domination framework suggests disparity and unevenness. Perhaps to best illustrate my point, or the apartheid framing, I'll use the example of conjugal violence. In the past, conjugal violence was seen as an internal conflict between the spouses. No intervention, don't get involved. An internal resolution is required. Mutual concessions are needed. Negotiations between the spouses are required. Today, conjugal violence is seen as a form of domination. You don't stand back, you intervene. You don't, external forces are required to stop the domination. There's a new framing for Israel, and that new framing is apartheid. It's not new for Palestinians. We've been saying this for decades. Human rights associations, organizations like Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International are saying it. Very recently, the Michael Link report, the Link report, the UN report, Michael Link is the rapporteur, special rapporteur on Israel, on the occupied Palestinian territories. And he just presented a report to the UN saying that Israel is an apartheid state. So to use a well-known image, the image of David and Goliath, David is Palestinian. David is Palestinian and Goliath is Israeli. We succeeded in overcoming political apartheid, not economic apartheid, in South Africa. So we've succeeded in South Africa. We will succeed in Israel-Palestine. Amandla, happy May Day.
Thank you very much, Denis. Aramal Majraj is a grade 8 student in the International Baccalaureate program in Brampton. He has written many poems, raps, and songs, especially for events like this. He is a cadet and scout, which is, enables him to enjoy activities like hiking and skating. Welcome, Aramal.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. So, I have done a lot of songs, poetries for Socialist Action, and I'll be doing something different today. I have created this sort of rap, if you want to say. So here it goes. This is not a fair society. The world's facing a huge calamity. The problems of the rich shall mash the poor. When we ask for fairness, they send us out the door, claiming we just ask for more. Thing is, we don't ask for enough. We think pizza will suffice, but in reality, it doesn't pay for their crimes. Only makes us think they care about our lives. Sad to say, money is the only thing making us strive. You think charity is there to feed? It only feeds the bourgeois greed. We're only here to please their needs. We want you to think differently. Either way, your seat's so but a peasant to breed. If you squabble with us, you won't achieve much. Squabble with them, they'll gun you down. Stand back up with nothing but a frown. But once you unite, there'll be a change of expression. Know that you're empowered, not the power of the nation. Not the ones that are biased declarations. Don't leave at the side of concession. We're asking for more. We're asking for a solution. If that's too much to ask, there's a problem with the system 300 years with no proper explanation. If revolution is of the past, why are the movements calling out corporations? Why are the people leaving food ration to ration? We're not the ones causing pollution. That's just your corporate delusion. This was all a planned execution, money pocketed, no correlation, while our whole lives depended on one promotion. Useless space strips for their entertainment, our strikes serve as amusement, but they won't like the coming movements because now's the time for a real revolution. It's a scheme. When you think that we're doomed, that's not just a dream. People are not awake yet, too busy with conspiracies on the internet. It's like the people in power wanted us to forget. Dystopian novels are the stories of our lives, but we're told not to fret. Forget the lies, live our lives, and never question the rest. If we did question more, we would be served with folklore. Oh, society has truly progressed.
Thank you so much. I wish all grade 8 students across the world were like you, comrade.
Thank you.
Okay. Emily Stairs is a leading member of Socialist Action Canada based in Guelph, Ontario. She helped to organize a union for teaching assistants at Wilfrid Laurier University in Waterloo and now sings in the community and works as a music teacher. So let's welcome Emily, who will now sing, recorded The Times They Are Changing. So let's bring on Emily.
Better start swimming or you'll
so much, Emily. As usual, that was beautiful. So folks, this is bringing us to the end of our program, and thanks to everyone who participated in tonight's event, with special thanks to our amazing technical producer, Dave Enning in Toronto. On Sunday, May the 1st, join Socialist Action and our labor and socialist partners in a big May Day rally and march starting at Toronto City Hall Square. Assemble at 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time. Due to the pandemic, as I said before, Socialist Action will be celebrating the 28th anniversary of Socialist Action by hosting an international educational conference online. It will be held on Saturday, June the 4th, a day of excellent topics, world-class speakers, and hot discussions. So please mark June the 4th on your calendar. For members and for folks who ask to join, please note that the Socialist Action Convention will be online a week later on Sunday, June the 12th. For more information about Socialist Action conferences, forums, film nights, and study groups held throughout the year, please send your phone number and email address to us at SA website, www.socialistaction.ca. So once again, thank you for all being here tonight. Have a revolutionary Red May Day, and make sure, I'm hoping to see everybody in the streets in Toronto on Saturday at 11:30. So stay safe, stay healthy, and be active. And I would like to end the program with some Irish words. Chuck e'ar law, our day will come. Bye for now.